Belinda presents this unabridged recording of Green Monkey Dreams, written and read by Isobelle Carmody. For Stephen, to whom all of my stories truly aspire. Zhuang Zi dreamed of being a butterfly, and while he was in the dream, he felt he could flutter his wings and everything was real. But on waking up, he realised that he was Zhuang Zi, and Zhuang Zi was real. Then he thought and wondered which was really real, whether he was really Zhuang Zi, dreaming of being a butterfly, or really a butterfly, dreaming of being Zhuang Zi. Lin Yu Tai, The Importance of Living. Part 1. The High Path. There are many sorrows in heaven waiting to be sent to us as angels. The Glory Days. They asked me to write down all I remember of the glory days. A hard thing, because there is so much of sorrow in the telling. My mind shies away from it, looping backwards and forwards in time. Last night, I thought of a girl I grew up with in the sister house who told me that mind birds sing a song just before the deadly gases kill them to lift their souls to heaven. Wakened this morning by the bells that toll the beginning of the solar day in freedom, I tried to remember her name and found I could not even recall her face. Hearing the bells ring now for dusk, I realize an entire day has passed like the blink of an eye. And it comes to me that if death is a kind of song that lifts the soul out of the body, sorrow too can steal a soul and carry it away. Perhaps that is what is wrong with me. Yet the story must be told, and there is no other but me to tell it. I must make them understand that there are many sorrows in heaven waiting to be sent to us as angels of death. I have told them, of course, but they nod soothingly and their eyes glide away. They think I am hallucinating, or perhaps that I am mad because of all that happened. They think of me as a child, telling themselves I was too young, blaming themselves. But if I learned one thing in glory, it is that flesh is the greatest lie. My youth was the main objection when I was proposed as an agent, but my sponsor was Erasmus, tribune of the body that administers freedom. He had been a very young man when he became tribune of freedom, first of all cities. He was one of the initiators of the plan to establish autonomous, self-regulating cities, which would have the same rights as a country once had over its citizens. And it is rumoured that it was his decision that bells be rung at dawn and dusk in gratitude that we wake and sleep in freedom. Erasmus is also my father, an archaic word. Very few children of freedom know or care who their progenitor is. Before the nation and country wars that changed the world forever, a woman bearing a child would remain together in one dwelling with that child and any others spawned by her and the man who impregnated her. The woman was owned by the man, and the children born to them were owned by both. There was even a contract of slavery in which she would vow to love and obey him before witnesses, as if loving was something that could be commanded. It was all part of that vast, greedy possessiveness of those times that people bound themselves together in little nations called families. Despite the fact that such conditions were inevitably destructive and more often than not produced psychologically flawed adults, this custom of families continued right up to the wars. Fortunately, the anarchy that followed, while dreadful, broke down the old, corrupt and meaningless systems. Now, it is not forbidden to know who one's mother or father is, just not important. We are all now sons and daughters of freedom, sisters and brothers to one another. A computer tells us when blood is wrong between a male and female for safe mating, but otherwise there are no divisions. In my mind, Erasmus was an older brother, and I was faintly shocked that he named me daughter. I put it down to his being of the generation that straddles the changes. Though he was one of the initiators of the modern age, he was a son of the old world, and it had left its mark on him. He saw my discomfort and said, "I tell you of the close blood between us, because I would ask you to do a thing which is more than I have a right to ask." I remember that I thought his eyes very sad and beautiful in his ugly boulder of a face. I had not been so close to him before, having only ever seen him during public addresses, and the contrast struck me. There was an expression in his eyes I did not understand. I know now it was guilt at the knowledge that his truest daughter was freedom, and that one daughter may be sacrificed to save another. "What do you want of me?" I asked, without the slightest sensible twinge of unease. I had grown up in freedom, and knew that I might say no if I wished to whatever he proposed, though he was the most powerful man in the city. It meant nothing to me that he was my father. I was about to learn that one could be compelled by honour and pride far more easily than by force. "You know that freedom sends emissaries to other cities, to Serenity and Winter?" I nodded, I think. "Because of trade and to stop inbreeding." He nodded too, but a little impatiently, as if I was behaving like a clever student when something more was wanted of me.
"Among other things, for trade, yes. Other sorts of emissaries are sent to the frontier cities like Fury."
"Agents," I said, remembering some gossip I had overheard. He blinked, and though his expression did not alter, I sensed his appraisal deepen.
"Do you know why we send agents, rather than diplomatic and official emissaries?"
I didn't. I had only overheard the word and assumed it was another name for emissary.
"Have you heard of glory?" he asked.
Another piece of gossip surfaced in my mind. "It's a frontier city."
He smiled then. "It is not common knowledge that we have located another city on the very edge of the wastes, but it does not surprise me that you have heard of it, my dear. I have kept an eye on your mentor reports over the years, and it has been observed more than once, and not always as a compliment, that you are in the habit of noticing rather more than people generally do."
"You monitored my progress. Why?" Embarrassment made me brusque.
"Curiosity. Your mother."
I flinched, and he frowned at me, but changed the subject abruptly.
"We needed a child who could..."
His voice trailed off, and I remember being startled. One did not think of the articulate, brilliant tribune being lost for words. That did make me feel a quiver of apprehension. But before I could fasten on it, he was going on, telling me that glory had been visited by freedom's emissaries, and, as with many of the frontier cities, they were refused entry. Only people wanting to join the city were allowed inside.
"Agents are sent in when emissaries are refused entry," Erasmus said.
I was shocked, because this flouted everything that freedom and the cities represented. Officially, a city might close its borders if it chose. Cities were small and could not increase beyond their walls, preventing the need for physical expansion. All cities were the same ground size. Numbers could increase, but only insofar as there was capacity for them. Cities like Winter were built up to house their population. When the population overgrew, another city would be built, and its builders would then design their own inner city matrix and modes of governance in accordance with whatever rules or ideals they had. No city could amalgamate with another, though people might shift between them. No city could interfere with another.
"We need to know what is happening in the new cities that are formed," Erasmus said. "We send agents in when emissaries are not permitted, merely to examine the social matrix, to ensure interference is not part of its mindset. None of the agents sent to glory returned, but we received enough information from them to indicate that glory has begun stockpiling ancient weaponry."
"How many agents were sent in?" I interrupted.
After a pause, he said, 20. but that information is strictly confidential.
My mouth fell open. When you say they did not return,
I mean they were never seen again. It is likely, most certainly likely, that they died, were killed to prevent them speaking of what they witnessed. We must know why and what is going on in Glory.
I knew then. We need a child, he had said. I had been consistently high in lessons with whichever mentor I chose, as he had observed, and I had already taken on the position of mentor to three younger sisters and a brother. One mentor told me I had a mind that leaped ahead of logic and reason, which made my work patchy and inconsistent, but occasionally inspired. I had been voted to lead the youth tribunal, but had preferred to sit as an independent and speak when the mood took me. In truth, I had feared boredom. Hearing of my refusal, my favorite mentor brother told me that there were three kinds of people: followers, leaders, and scouts. Scouts were capable of leadership, but they could not tolerate the responsibility of it. Disinclined to take orders either, they invariably flouted authority and fomented strife. This was why scouts, he said wryly, were the first to be sent into danger. It was half hoped they would be killed.
I fear you are destined to trouble us as a scout, little sister, he said. All of the agents lost were adults,
Erasmus was saying.
We now feel that the deepest heart of Glory is too rigid for an adult outsider to infiltrate.
I was nodding, and so he stopped. He was too clever to overstate.
You must think it over, he said.
But he knew, and I knew, that there was no choice. 20 dead because they had entered one of the closed frontier cities? Dead why? What had they seen? That was what I was to find out. To seek knowledge was not interference. Have you any information about the city? I asked, about its culture and traditions, its laws.
Little enough, I am afraid, Erasmus said. Closed and focused around a central religion called the High Path, its people worship a figure known as the Angel.
It was to his credit that he did not balk at the word. The Angel? I asked. Is their religion another version of ancient Christianity? Do they worship an angel as a god, or is it an idol?
The angel is a real person, with the power of life and death over his followers. As you know, we do not interfere in internal politics or religions, so long as citizens are free to leave a city if they choose it. But in this case, agents were prevented from leaving, and there is the real possibility that Glory will use its arsenal against other cities. We want to know if they plan to make war on nearby cities, or on one city in particular. If possible, we need to know where their arsenal is stored.
Information, then? I asked crisply, thinking that was not too great a thing to ask, forgetting what Erasmus wanted and what Glory would demand of me might be two different things. The healer, Lore, visits me, interrupting my memories. I cannot say I regret it.
You must get up, go outside. It will do you good to walk about and exercise your limbs, lest they begin to atrophy, she says, somewhat sternly, as if my inactivity is willful and stubborn. I have a sudden muddied memory of being dragged from rubble, my bones grinding together, my face streaming with blood and tears. I had not known, when I first woke, why I wept. The memories of the last day had been crushed out of me by the stone teeth of Glory, lethal even as it fell. A blessed, if fleeting, forgetting. When I woke the second time from a nightmare of drowning, I was in freedom, and Lore was leaning over me. I had never met her before, and thought I was in Glory still. Then she spoke, and I knew I was home. There were no healers in Glory. When she realized I could not speak, she pressed a pencil and paper into my fingers. I lay there, cradling them without the strength even to write, and asked.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.